Welcome back to my channel. My name is Brandon and today I have a huge book haul. It's over 60 books. I've been collecting these books since November, and so that's been 6 months. 60 books in 6 months is a lot, but most of these are used books anyway, so didn't really spend that much. But I'm just gonna hop on in. The first one I don't actually have with me because I let my friends borrow it after I got done reading it, and that is The Grown Up by Gillian Flynn. This was a novella that is like Gillian Flynn's take on a haunted house story. And since it's so short, it's only like 60 something pages, I'm not gonna go into the synopsis, but just know it's Gillian Flynn's take on the haunted house story. And she wrote Gone Girl, Dark Places, Sharp Objects, all of those books. So if you enjoyed those books, I'm sure you'll probably enjoy this novella. I sure did. I gave it a 5 out of 5 stars. I really enjoyed it. So that's the first one on this list. The second one I have, I got at my local bookstore for, I think, like 50 cents. And I've been looking for this book for forever. And it is in really great condition. And that is The Velvet Rage by Alan Downs, Dr. Alan Downs. And this is the second edition, so it's been updated. But the back of the book says, today's gay man enjoys unprecedented, hard-won social acceptance, and yet despite this victory, serious problems still exist. Substance abuse, depression, suicide, and sex addiction are at an all-time high, causing us to ask, are we really better off? So it's just a self-help book of sorts for the gay man, it seems. So I'm excited about it. This is the cover. Nothing too special, just a kid with a pink tie. Guess that means he's gay, right? But no, I've heard great things about it. I remember Tyler Oakley a long time ago in a video talking about this book. And ever since then, I've wanted to read it. So plan to get to this one hopefully soon. The next book that I have is What's Wrong with Homosexuality by John Corvino. And this is just a group of essays going into a lot of the different arguments that people say are reasons why homosexuality is bad and kind of debunking them. So I'm excited to get into this text and kind of put some new tools in my arsenal for arguing with bigots. So I'm excited about this one. Next, we have one that was my first read of the year and probably my favorite book of the year so far. And that is Rachel Bloom's I Want to Be Where the Normal People Are. And it is a signed edition. Let's see. Here we go. Bloom. So Rachel Bloom is a phenomenal woman in general, but actress, writer, producer of shows, I believe, as well. So she is the producer, actress, and writer of one of my favorite shows, and that is Crazy Ex-Girlfriend on the CW. It is no longer running. It is reached its conclusion, but it's phenomenal, like incredible. It's so funny. The show is a musical of sorts about this girl's journey with coming to terms with who she is. The show is just hilarious. The music is phenomenal, and I fell in love with it when I came out. As I came out, I was really depressed, obviously, because things didn't go as well as one would hope. But this show really showed me the light at the end of the tunnel and made me feel all kinds of emotions, and I just loved it. And I was devastated when it ended, but I think they did a good run. But in Rachel Bloom's I Want to Be Where the Normal People Are, she is just chronicling different events in her life, and it's hilarious. And she changes up the format quite a bit. There's like, you know, play format. There are different poems or like songs written. It's just, it's a phenomenal, phenomenal book, and I just love it so much. And there are even pictures included. It's so funny. I was literally cracking myself up the entire time. Definitely check this out if you haven't already. The next book that I have is Lost at Sea by John Ronson. I, earlier this year in 2021, read So You've Been Publicly Shamed by John Ronson, and I saw this at my local used bookstore. And it made me want to pick it up because I was kind of enjoying So You've Been Publicly Shamed. And it just says, in Lost at Sea, John Ronson investigates the strange things we're willing to believe in, from robots programmed with our loved ones' personalities to indigo children to the insane clown posse's Juggalo fans. He looks at ordinary lives that take in extraordinary perspectives. I'm excited to read it. I just feel like this book sounds super insightful and will provide a bunch of fun facts about life in general and our world. I think too, when I took that strengths-based personality assessment thing for my work, I found out that my number one strength was input. And when I read that, I was like, okay, that sounds kind of boring. And it kind of is, but basically one of the key elements of input is that we like to store information. And that explains so much about my life. I know so many useless facts. Like when I watch Jeopardy, I'm killing it because I know so many things that just the regular person shouldn't even know. Like why would you know that? But I know those things. I pay attention and like I cling to like useless fun facts. And I feel like this book will give me a lot of those to keep storing in my brain. So I'm excited about that. The next one I bought purely for the cover and for the author as well, and that is Music for Chameleons by Truman Capote. I have In Cold Blood by Truman Capote that I wish to read this year, actually. And I was drawn in by this cover because it has Marilyn Monroe, and I think it looks beautiful. So basically, in this book, Truman Capote chronicles the lives of four independent people and what drives them, what motivates them in life, and he just writes about them. It's like vignettes of these people, and so I'm really excited to get into it. The next book I have is a pretty weird one, but I am completely okay with that, and that is Killer Cults, Stories of Charisma, Deceit, and Death by Stephen Singular, and I'm really, really excited to read this. I have always really found cults fascinating. I know that sounds really bad, but I have. I've always been fascinated with the manipulation that goes into it and a lot of times the narcissism from the leaders of these cults and what people have to go through in order to kind of fall prey to cults. And so this just kind of has all of the well-known cults and all the information that you need to know on them. And so I'm excited to get to this one. The next book I have is another weird one, but one that I'm excited to get to nonetheless, and that is Sons of Cain by Peter Vronsky, and this is a history of serial killers from the Stone Age to the present. Again, I know it's weird. I have been finding my love for true crime in book form. I have always loved it in TV and movies, and I've just recently kind of got into the realm of true crime in literature, and so I really want to read this. Sounds weird. I'm fascinated with serial killers. Not really like fangirling over Ted Bundy kind of fascinated, but just like, I like learning about them and how they got to where they were and the victim stories and things like that. And I know it's macabre. I know it's, you know, morbid, but it's an interest of mine. So I'm excited to get to this and kind of see the progression of the different serial killers throughout time. All right, so the next one I saw at the bookstore and I just had to get, and that is A Fatal Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, Murder in Ancient Rome by Emma Southen. And first of all, I just love this cover, the millennial pink with the statue of antiquity, as well as the daggers going through and the blood dripping down. I really love the design for this a lot. So basically, this is like a true crime novel of sorts, but about ancient Rome. And it talks about how Rome viewed murder, how Rome viewed crimes relating to murder and, you know, inflicting bodily harm. And, you know, we look back on those times, as not to say it was barbaric, because it wasn't barbaric. I mean, they were pretty intelligent. But we see this society as one that loves violence, right? They had the Colosseum, the gladiators, they had the Olympics, which sometimes included some dark things. They had the myths that were focused on gore. Their origin story of Rome was that a brother killed his brother in order to be the emperor of Rome. So they were fascinated with this idea of violence. And I think it's interesting to take a look from Dr. Southen's perspective, not necessarily her perspective, but her, you know, research on what people's feelings and thoughts and stuff on death and violence really were during that time. Because we kind of look back like, oh, they loved it, but we don't know. And I'm gonna find out when reading this, so I'm excited to get to it. The next two books I have actually already read, and they kind of go in tandem. They are both true crime books based around queer people. And that is First Missing from the Village by Justin Ling. And this is about a group of Asian Canadian men who go missing from the village in Toronto and how no one really cared. And the police didn't do their job. And the families of these people and the chosen families of these people really tried to get the ball rolling and the police just weren't having it. And it talks about the injustice of queer people in general. It even mentions North Carolina in this book, like shout out. I believe it was to Durham, North Carolina, which is where my boyfriend's from. It may have been Raleigh, but I think it was Durham. Anyway, this was just a really great book. I really enjoyed Justin Lane's commentary and the view of this case through his eyes, because he was kind of going along as it was happening, trying to figure out what was going on. And once we got to the bottom of it as a reader, we could see that it was kind of like he had just come to terms with it as well. And we get to see his anger and his frustration and his lack of empathy for the police, because again, they just did not care when it came to the missing queer Asian Canadians at that time. And so it was a perfect book to read during, I was actually reading this during the time in our American society where we were talking about stopping Asian hate because of the horrible, horrible incident that happened in America earlier this year. So this was just perfectly timed for me to read. I really enjoyed it. I thought it was very insightful. I gave it like a 4-star, I think. I really enjoyed it. So if you're interested, definitely check it out. And the second of those two, true crime based around queer people, I have Last Call by Elon Green, a true story of love, lust, and murder in queer New York. I read this in like a day. It was phenomenal. It is, like I said, a true crime book following the Last Call killer who was killing gay men from bars between the 80s and the 90s. And basically they called him the Last Call killer because he would go to a bar, find a guy, take him home, kill him, and mutilate their bodies in unbelievable ways. And they were all older queer men as well. Well, not all. There was like one younger guy, but mostly older queer men. And they found out who it was. I'm not gonna say, because you can read this. Or they have a Forensic Files episode of it too. So if you wanna watch that, you can. It was crazy because right after I finished this, 2 days later, I was watching Forensic Files on Pluto TV because I just have that on in the mornings when I get ready. And it was the episode about the Last Call killer. And I was like, okay, I know I'm supposed to be getting ready for work, but I'm just gonna sit and watch this because I kind of want to know how it compares to this book. I really enjoyed this book. I did feel like I liked this book a bit more than I did Missing from the Village, though I think Missing from the Village had a lot more modern commentary because it happened much more recently. I liked the writing of this one better. I liked the take of this one better, and I like how victim focused it was. We didn't really get to know who the Last Call killer was until the very end, and then it wasn't super focused on him. It was more focused on the victims and their lives. And I really enjoyed that because it very much humanized these victims. And I don't feel like a lot of true crime does that. And I was very pleased to see it happen in here. So I believe this one got like a 4.5 out of 5 for me. I really enjoyed it. So check this one out too, if you haven't already. So the next book I have is Leaves of Grass by Walt Whitman, which I love this cover. I think it's so minimal, so cute. And I was reading some Walt Whitman with my students in English 3, and I was like, you know, I kind of like his writing. Some of it is a little bit dated and a little bit, I don't want to say blatantly racist, but racist in the fact that it negates discussing the blatant racism in early America. But Walt Whitman was a queer poet that really enjoyed himself, a younger guy, not like pedophilia level, but I think he and Oscar Wilde may have shared a kiss or a little more than a kiss. Oscar Wilde being the guy who wrote The Picture of Dorian Gray, which I read last year. Walt Whitman's poetry, I do enjoy. I think there are some really good ones, but some of them just seem to lack the focus on diversity and the issues that were really going on in America during colonization, because he just praised America. He was very like Americana mindset, and he thought everything America did was fantastic, and I don't necessarily agree with that. So yeah, but I do want to read more of his poetry. I do want to give more of him a shot than just what's in my students' textbooks for English 3. So this is Leaves of Grass. All right, next we have a set of books that I got from my local used bookstore, and they are the Dan Valentine books. So first we have Vermilion, let's see, there you go, you can see now. Then we have Cobalt, then we have Slate, and lastly we have, let's see if I can hold this one, Canary. So these are four gay detective noir books. And earlier this year I read some detective noir and really enjoyed it. And I saw that they had some ones about gay men at my local used bookstore. And I was like, you know what? Let me check these out. So I haven't read them yet, but I do, you know, like that all four of them are just right here. They are matching copies. Hopefully they're good. I haven't read a lot of queer literature from this looks like 80s. Let's see when it was published. In 1980. I haven't read many, if any, queer books from the 80s, so I'm excited to see what these are like and if they are kind of holding that 80s nostalgia, which we all know I love. But yes, oh, by the way, they are by Nathan Aldean, but I hope to get to these soon because I do want to give them a shot and see if they're worth the 25 cents each that I paid for them at my local used bookstore. So hopefully they are. All right, next we have The Death of Vivek Oji by Akweke Emezi. And I have already read Pet by Akweke Emezi. I already own Freshwater by Akweke Emezi. And I've heard nothing but amazing things about The Death of Vivek Oji. And I really want to get into it very soon. As for the synopsis of this book, I don't want to know a lot about it, but I will read you the first sentence that just tells me it's going to be heartbreaking already. And it says, one afternoon in a town in southeastern Nigeria, a mother opens her front door to discover her son's body wrapped in colorful fabric at her feet. Oh. So yeah, I am already feeling like traumatized. That's why I haven't read it yet. Because I've heard fantastic things, but I'm just so nervous that I'm going to be wrecked by it, because I know I am. Akweke Emezi is a trans non-binary author whose books are usually own voices, and so they write a lot about characters within the LGBTQ plus community, and I think this book is no different. So I'm excited to see what this book holds. The next book that I have is Real Life by Brandon Taylor, and I have heard really great things about this from my coworker, Mrs. Karp, if you're watching, hello. So Mrs. Karp is the only other member of the Alphabet Mafia at my work with me, and she recommended that I read Real Life by Brandon Taylor. She said it's kind of like Hidden Figures, the movie, but about a black queer man, and it is said to take place in, I think, like 24 hours or something like that. So I'm excited to read it. I think it sounds great. I don't want to read the synopsis because it is kind of a shorter book and I don't want to be spoiled. Plus she just said it was phenomenal and I should go in without knowing too much. So that's what I plan to do. So I'm excited for it. The next book that I have, I am so excited for. And when I saw it in the bookstore, I could not pass it up. I just had to buy it in that moment. And that is Gay Bar by Jeremy Atherton Lynn. And this just, first of all, looks phenomenal. I love that cover. It's very gay club. But I'm just gonna read you the synopsis that drew me in, along obviously with the cover, because how could it not? It says, does gay still have a place? Strobing lights in dark rooms, drag queens on counters, first kisses, last call, the gay bar has long been a place of solidarity and sexual expression. Now they are closing. A cultural demolition that has Jeremy Atherton Lynn wondering, could this spell the end of gay identity as we know it? In prose as exuberant as a hit of poppers and dazzling as a disco ball, the author embarks on a transatlantic tour of the hangouts that marked his life, with each club, pub, and dive revealing itself to be a palimpsest of queer history. Gay Bar time travels from Hollywood nights in the 1970s to a warren of cruising tunnels built beneath London in the 1770s, from chichi bars in the wake of AIDS to totally fluid queer spaces through glory holes into Crisco slicked dungeons and down San Francisco alleys. It sounds so phenomenal. It's okay. Also, look at that spine. Can we just, like, yes, please. So I'm really excited to get to this one as well. The next book is an ARC that I was gifted by Algonquin Publishers, and that is Let's Get Back to the Party by Zach Salih. And I read this book earlier this year in anticipation for its release in February, on February 16th. And I gave my review for it, obviously, before it came out. And I really wanted to enjoy this book. I gave it like a 2 out of 5 stars, I believe. Looking back, it probably was a 2.5. There were some really redeemable qualities to it, but overall, I kind of found this book a little boring, a little like boomer-ish. But overall, I think it had some good things to say, some interesting things to say. There was also some like sexual encounters with minors that I was not the biggest fan of. So that's that. But that's Let's Get Back to the Party by Zach Solly. Next, I have Memorial by Brian Washington. I hate that it has this GMA book club sticker that does not come off on it, but I am excited nonetheless to get to this. I've heard phenomenal things. I remember Noelle talking about it and saying it's like about a gay relationship, but not about a gay relationship. It's about two gay men who are in a relationship, but it's about their lives separately. And I really enjoy that because I think it's important to kind of have your own independence. And I feel like there's not many books that kind of focus on the independence of the members within a relationship. It's always about them together. So I'm excited to see what this book has to offer. The next two books that I have are from the same author, and that is A Darker Shade of Magic and Vicious by V.E. Schwab. I've heard nothing but fantastic things about both of these books, and I'm excited to get to them. This one is about magicians going through parallel universes in London, and that's all I know about it, really. This one is about two college friends who try to create superpowers, and once they do, they get imprisoned, and then once they get out, they are arch nemeses. That's all I know about this one. So I hope that both of these live up to the hype. There's not much I know about them other than that they're great. So I'm excited to get to these. The next book that I have is Gods of Jade and Shadow by Silvia Moreno Garcia. I'm so excited to get to this book. It is pitched as like an adult Percy Jackson, but with Mayan gods. And that sounds fantastic. I don't know much about Mayan gods, but I would love to learn more based on this book. So plus the cover is just stunning. I love it. I'm excited to get to this one. Next, we have a classic that I've been waiting to read for forever, but it scares me because it's huge, and that is Ulysses by James Joyce. I read some excerpts from Ulysses when I was a freshman in college, and I adored what I had to read. I remember being like, I am going to read that book one day. I just am, and finally I bought it because I'm like, I need to read it soon. Today is the day. Well, not necessarily today, but you get what I'm saying. There's not much I know about this one either, other than it's like James Joyce's take on the Odyssey by Homer, and I believe it may be modernized. So, yeah, I'm excited to get to it. Ulysses by James Joyce. The next book that I have is So You Want to Talk About Race, and I am really excited about this one. I got this at my used bookstore as well, and I've heard nothing but fantastic things. It's going to go right on my shelf with all my other anti-racist books so that I can get through those as well. I've only read White Fragility so far, but I need to get through the rest, and this was one that I'm adding to that list, so I'm excited to get to it and see what it has to offer. The next book that I have is The Handmaid's Tale by Margaret Atwood. I've heard phenomenal things. I've never read it, definitely haven't seen the show on Hulu, but I do want to read it before I watch the show. There's not too much I know about it, and I don't want to know so much because I kind of feel like it would be spoilery, but I do know that it's like based in this dystopian future, and women are supposed to have babies for these men, but like they're not married to them or dating them. It's like that's their job, is to have babies. That's all I understand about it. But I remember seeing a trailer for Margaret Atwood's masterclass in writing, and it talks about her, you know, the Little Red Riding Hood, but let's start with a little bit of extra pizzazz. And she's like, it was dark inside the belly of the wolf. And I was like, okay, bitch, like that's fire, girl. Okay. So I'm excited to see what Margaret Atwood's writing is like. I've never read any of her work, so I plan to get to this one very soon. Next, we have one that I really, really want to read. We started reading it when I was in like 7th grade in my class, but it either had an explicit sex scene or maybe even rape scene. I don't 100% remember. But that book is The Color Purple by Alice Walker. I adore this edition. I think it's so stunning, so beautiful, so minimal. And everyone that I know that has seen this movie loves it. And I have not yet seen the movie in its entirety. I've seen bits and pieces growing up. but I want to read this before I actually watch the movie. And I know it's going to be hard to read. I've heard that there are dramatic elements in it. But I'm hoping that I really enjoy reading this book and find, you know, what I'm supposed to take away from it while reading it. So there's The Color Purple. The next three books that I have are by the same author, Jorge Simenon, and that is Mr. Hyre's Engagement, The Late Monsieur Gallet, and then The Carter of La Providence. I probably butchered all of those names, but I saw these in my local bookstore, and like I said, I've been trying to get more into like detective fiction, mystery, noir. I really liked what I read earlier this year, and these sound very interesting. The next book that I have, I'm so excited about, and that is The Decameron Project, 29 New Stories from the Pandemic, selected by the editors of the New York Times Magazine. So this is a revamp of The Decameron Project that happened after, I believe it was the Black Plague. A bunch of authors kind of had this group of, or had this selection of short stories that they had written during this time period and combined it all into The Decameron Project. And then once COVID struck, we created The Decameron Project again with some really famous authors. We got Mona Awad, Tommy Orange, Margaret Atwood, River Solomon, and so many more. So I'm excited to see what all of these authors have to offer. And I really like short fiction, especially when it's multiple authors, because I kind of get to see if I like a certain author, if I want to check out more of their work. But I am so excited to read this, and I do want to read it before the pandemic kind of comes to an end, which I know kind of sounds a bit morbid, but you know, I want to be able to say I read this during the pandemic in which it was about. So yeah, I'm excited to get to this. The next book that I have is a plan for a video very soon, so I don't want to give too much away for that, but it's Norwegian Wood by Haruki Murakami, and I am so excited to get to this. I don't know much about it other than I believe it's like a journey, a book about a journey, an adventure, and it's a Murakami, which people love, and there's one person that loves this book in particular that is the reason that I'm going to be reading it for a specific video that you will see very soon. So I'm excited to get to this one and to find out exactly what it's about, because I don't know much more than what I shared with you all. So that is Norwegian Wood. And next we have Looker by Lara Sims, which is about a girl who becomes obsessed with her neighbor, who is an actress, and begins to stalk her, and things go awry very quickly. It is extremely short. So I hope to get to this very soon because I'm hoping that it's gonna be great. I love a good stalker story. Those are very, very creepy to me. So I'm hoping that this delivers on that. The next book that I have is another one that you'll see why exactly I'm reading it in an upcoming video, but that is Letters to a Young Poet by Rainer Maria Rilke. And I have already read this and thoroughly enjoyed it. There are so many things that I kind of marked up throughout here because he had a lot of really good things to say. And there's not, which it was probably new for him at the time, but we have heard a lot of what he has to say in our society now. And I think that it's a lot of good stuff. And I thoroughly enjoyed it. I think I gave it a 4 out of 5 stars. Really enjoyed it. But this is just his letters to a young aspiring poet. And he just gives them some motivation, some inspiration. And it's really beautiful. And I really enjoyed reading the letters. Next two books that we have are by the same author, Ernest Hemingway. And we have The Old Man and the Sea, as well as The Sun Also Rises. I've never read any Ernest Hemingway books. But I am very excited to get into these soon. Again, I don't know anything about them. I know that's kind of boring. I don't really want to know too much, but I've heard great things. They're classics for a reason, and I want to see what exactly all the hype is about. So I'm excited to get to these two. Next, we have Crime and Punishment by Fyodor Dostoevsky, and I enjoy that this kind of matches my Lord of the Flies, Penguins Classics Deluxe Editions with the art style. There's not much I know about Crime and Punishment. I know it's about revenge. I know it's about crime and punishment. And so I kind of want to wait to find out exactly what it's about until I'm going to read it. I know it's kind of boring for you all, for me to be doing that. So I'm really excited to get into this one very soon. The next book is the one I'm currently reading, and this is another one that is for a future video that you will figure out why later, and that is Autobiography of Red by Ann Carson, and this follows Geryon, like a different take on the myth of Geryon, and who he was before Heracles killed him for one of his labors. Spoiler alert. But this book so far is tragic, is beautiful, is haunting, is dark, and I'm enjoying it. So I'm not very far. I'm only like 30 something pages in, but so far I'm really enjoying it and I can't wait to see what it has to offer soon. But it's written in verse, so that's great. But yeah, so that is Autobiography of Red by Ann Carson. Next, I have Circe by Madeline Miller, and I read Son of Achilles earlier, well, last year actually, by Madeline Miller, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I loved it so much, and this follows our main character, Circe, who we see in Homer's The Odyssey a bit as a character where she's a witch of sorts that kind of keeps Odysseus on her island for a while. But this story, from my understanding, is where we get to learn more about her and her motivations and things like that. So I'm excited to get to it. I really enjoyed Son of Achilles by Madeline Miller. I don't think I'll like this one as much because it's not super queer from my understanding, but I do want to read it and I do think I will enjoy it nonetheless, even if I don't enjoy it as much as Son of Achilles. The next two books that I have are by the same author, and I'm still waiting on the third. It hasn't come out yet, but I have pre-ordered it. And those are Mythos and Heroes by Stephen Fry. Look how big these books are. They're huge. They're as big as my head. But these are Stephen Fry's take on mythology, Greek and Roman mythology. And Stephen Fry is hilarious. He is a British celebrity. I mean, he just does a lot. But he wrote these two, and he has the third one coming out very soon called Troy. But I'm just really excited to get into these. They have pictures. It's a bit bigger, obviously, to read. Okay, can we get to the pictures? Okay, there's one. Pictures. That one's not super interesting, but regardless, I'm really excited to get to this and just read his interpretation of a lot of these classic myths. But also, the covers for these underneath are just as gorgeous as they are on the outside, which I love. I love the gold foil on these, though. Don't get me wrong, but the Mythos, you can see somewhere here. So I'm really excited about these, and I hope to get to them very soon. So, yes. The next book that I have is Clown in a Cornfield by Adam Cesare. I'm not 100% sure I'm pronouncing that correctly, but this is a young adult slasher book. Not read one of those yet, so I'm excited to get to this. It also involves clowns, obviously. It sounds just super campy, super fun, super like Scream. So I'm excited for this. I found it at my used bookstore for like $3. I was like, absolutely, hand it to me now. So I hope to get to this. I actually really do want to get to this very soon because like I said, I love a good slasher. Those are my favorite movies. I've not read many slasher books, so this will be one of the first that I've read, and I'm excited about that. The next book that I have is The Sacrifice Box by Martin Stewart. I have not heard much about this book. It's kind of weird. I just watched a video of horror recommendations where Etu Brody recommended this book. So basically, it's just the sacrifice box where people go in the woods and sacrifice something into this box, and as long as you keep your promise, you're good. But if you break that promise, the objects in which you sacrifice are gonna come back and seek vengeance. So I'm excited to get to this. It does sound super fun. I really enjoy the cover, very 80s horror, which I love. But I plan to get to this very, very soon. The next book I have is a novella, actually. It's very, very short. Let's see, it's only 70 pages, and that is Sour Candy by Keelan Patrick Burke. I've heard phenomenal things about this. I know he also wrote Blanky, which is a lot of people's favorite. Have not read Blanky yet, but if I enjoy this, I will definitely be giving Blanky a try. But look how it's like so small. Like, it's so small, there aren't even words printed on the side. Like, it's that small. So I'm so excited that I have this and that I'm able to read it, and I will be getting to this like 2-3 books from now. So be looking forward to this. The next book that I have is Psycho by Robert Bloch, and this is, yes, that Psycho that inspired Alfred Hitchcock's film. I didn't know it was based on a book, so that's exciting for me. I'm super interested to get into it. It's only about 100 pages or so, super short, But I'm excited to see how much it relates to the movie. Love the movie so much. I love Alfred Hitchcock in general. I'm not 100% sure how the novel is going to compare. Hopefully it's better, but you know, sometimes it doesn't really meet the expectations. So I'm hoping that this one does. And I love the cover that it's got the shower scene. Oh, love. Next, we have another horror classic, and that is The Exorcist by William Peter Blatty. What is to say? It's about this young girl who gets possessed and the people trying to exorcise this demon from her. Heard a taunting. Never seen the movie. I know, I'm a horror fan and never seen the movie. Please don't kill me. But I did want to read the book first. And so that's why I have it. I plan to get into it very, very soon. And then once I read it, I can watch the movie and let you know my thoughts. So I'm excited to get to this. Next, we have yet another horror classic. I am sensing a trend here. We have The Haunting of Hill House by Shirley Jackson. I don't really know how this book is going to go because Netflix's adaptation has modernized it, but this book was written so long ago. I'm not 100% sure if it's going to, I mean, obviously it's not going to be the same, but I want to know how much of it is very similar to the actual, you know, TV show. So I loved the Netflix adaptation, but I'm hoping that I will love the novel just as much. Next, we have three Stephen King books. We have Different Seasons, which is a, I would say, novella collection. Some people say short story, but it's really just four novellas. One of which is The Body, which inspired Stand By Me. I believe The Shawshank Redemption is also in here. Let's see. Yes, The Shawshank Redemption has Apt Pupil. That was another one that turned into a movie. And then we have The Breathing Method, which I've never heard of. So really excited to get to these. Three really great novellas in here and one that I've never heard of, but it may be great as well. I mean, it's Stephen King, All Hail the Queen, am I right? So the second Stephen King book I have is The Dark Half, which sounds incredibly interesting. It's again about a writer. Stephen King does that a lot. And it's about him using a pseudonym, which Stephen King did as Richard Bachman, which is one of my favorite books by him. He wrote as Richard Bachman, which was The Long Walk. But it seems like his pseudonym that has passed away, that he's no longer using, is taking a life of its own and is seeking vengeance on our main author. So that sounds incredibly interesting. I'm excited to see where this goes. And lastly, we have Insomnia by Stephen King, which follows like this really old couple, which I've never read a book following an old couple. So that should be interesting. This is almost 900 pages. It's huge. But it says, Ralph Roberts never expected to live out his remaining golden years mourning the death of his beloved wife. He also never expected to begin suffering from chronic insomnia for the first time in his life. Each night he wakes up a little bit earlier until he's barely sleeping at all. During his overnight walks, he's now observing some strange things going on here in Derry, Maine. And they're more than sleep-deprived hallucinations. There's definitely a mean streak that's always been running through the small New England city. Underneath its ordinary surface, awesome and terrifying forces are at work. The dying has been going on in Derry for a long, long time, and Ralph Roberts will soon find that lack of sleep is the least of his worries. Sounds haunting, terrifying. Sounds almost like The Nightmare on Elm Street, where the kids kind of tried to stop sleeping and all of the hallucinations that ensued. So I'm excited to get into this and to be like, is it real? Is it a dream? Is it a hallucination? What's going on? So Insomnia by Stephen King. So I forgot that we have actually more Stephen King. Three more to be exact. The first one being Dr. Sleep by Stephen King. This is the sequel to The Shining, which I read this year and loved so much. I love the movie. I've already seen the movie for this book as well, but I'm hoping that this will be different than the movie. I really enjoyed the movie, like I said, but I want this to be just as good as, if not better, than The Shining itself. So excited to get into this. The next two books that I have are Firestarter and Cujo by Stephen King. Cujo is about a rabid dog who holds a family hostage in their car, and Firestarter is about a girl who has pyrokinesis, on the run with her dad from federal agents looking to use her as a weapon for their government. So these two I'm also excited about. And also these covers are just stunning. I love the Signet classics. Anyway, speaking of mass market paperback editions, I have some more for you that I found at my local used bookstore. The first one being The Hunting Season by John Coyne. This reminds me a lot of the movie Wrong Turn. It's about this woman who takes her family to the outskirts of this like lack of civilization, I guess, in the woods where these inbred cannibals live, and she's trying to research them, and then things go awry. Obviously, it's a thriller and a horror book, so I'm excited to get to it. Hopefully it's great. So we'll see. I'm excited to see where this goes. Next, we have Drawing Blood by Poppy Z. Bright. This takes place in North Carolina, and it's also queer. I think it's a queer vampire tale. I don't know much about it. I've heard it's terrifying. I looked up like horrifying books that take place in North Carolina or horrifying queer books, and this popped up on both of those lists, and so I was like, I need to check that out. Also by Poppy Z. Bright, I have Lost Souls. Not so sure what this one is about, but they had both of these there at my local used bookstore, and I was like, well, if I'm getting this one, I might as well get this one too. They were like 25 cents a piece. I couldn't pass them up, so excited to get to both of these, but mainly Drawing Blood. And lastly, I have a Clive Barker mass market paperback, and that is The Damnation Game. I'm excited to get into this one. It sounds really haunting. I don't know much about it. I've heard great things, so I'm excited to get into this one as well. Next, we have House of Leaves by Mark Z. Danielewski. I have not read this book. I was gonna read it with the Literally Dead book club, but did not get to it. I read the first maybe 20, 30 pages, and I just could not get into it, so I put it down. But I do wanna keep it because I wanna get into it one day when I have the time to actually sit down and read it. I was looking for something kind of light and easy to read, and this just seems like something that's gonna be pretty difficult and time consuming. So I want to read this one day. A lot of people really love it. A lot of horror fans especially love it. So I wanna give it a shot when I have the time and the capability to. So that is House of Leaves. Next we have The Southern Book Club's Guide to Slaying Vampires by Grady Hendrix. I loved My Best Friend's Exorcism by Grady Hendrix. It's one of my favorite like horror comedy books that I've ever read. And this sounds like it's just right up my alley as well. I believe it takes place in Charleston. So very close to home, but it's about a group of women who have a book club in the South. And there's a vampire in their town and they have to learn how to fend him off. At least that's what it sounds like. So I'm excited to get to this one very, very soon. The next book that we have is Sharp Objects by Gillian Flynn. I have never read this book, but my friends Simone and Kayla adore it, and they really like the mini series as well, but they obviously like the book a bit more. I'm actually currently reading this book as well, currently on chapter 3, so I'm about 30 pages in, and I'm liking it so far. Nothing crazy has happened. There's not much to report back to you on so far, but I am excited to get into it. And to see what it's about. I have not read the synopsis because I'm like, I just need to go into it. It's so short, I don't want to be spoiled for anything. And my friends were like, just don't read the synopsis, just go into it. So that's what I'm doing. And so far so good. We'll see where we turn up at the end. But if it's anything like The Grown Up that I mentioned at the beginning of this video, I will love it. The Grown Up got a 5 out of 5 stars for me. So hopefully this one will be just the same. Next, we have The Death of Mr. Westaway by Ruth Weir. I read The Turn of the Key by Ruth Weir last year, as well as One by One. Loved The Turn of the Key, liked One by One, and I hear a lot of people say that either The Death of Mr. Westaway or The Turn of the Key are their favorites. And since I love Turn of the Key, I'm assuming that I'm gonna love The Death of Mr. Westaway. And like I said, I liked One by One, and people seem to rank that one pretty low under this one. So I'm like, well, if I liked One by One, then surely I will like this one as well. If I don't love it, then I'll at least like it. So I'm excited to get to this one. Next, we have what I've heard is like the Queer Secret History. Wasn't the biggest fan of the Secret History, as you all saw in my 2020 wrap-up video. Wasn't the biggest fan, but hopefully this one is a lot better. And that is These Violent Delights by Micah Nimeriver? Sorry if I said the name wrong. But that's all I know about this book, is that it's pitched as a queer secret history. So we'll see if that's true or not. Next, we have The 7.5 Deaths of Evelyn Hardcastle by Stuart Turton. I love the premise of this book that I've heard people talk about, where our main character dies and wakes up in a new body of someone within this like murder mystery party thing. And we keep waking up in a new person's body every single time until we find out who the murderer is. So I love that premise, and I think it sounds beautiful, as well as the cover, which is stunning, very like 20s vibes. very, very much looking forward to getting into this one. Next, we have one that I used to own and then sold my copy, which I hate. But I finally found a new copy at my used bookstore, and that was Dark Matter by Blake Crouch. I've heard nothing but phenomenal things. It's supposed to be a sci-fi thriller book, and that's all I really need to know. Very Black Mirror vibes is what I'm getting, so I'm really excited to get into this one. The next book that I have, I'm also super excited about getting into, and I think the premise just sounds so creepy, and there's so much potential here, and hopefully it lives up to the potential, and that is Leave the World Behind by Rahman Alam. And it says, Amanda and Clay head out to a remote corner of Long Island expecting a vacation, a quiet reprieve from life in New York City, quality time with their teenage son and daughter, and a taste of the good life in the luxurious home they've rented for the week. But with a late-night knock on the door, the spell is broken. Ruth and G.H., an older couple who claim to own the home, have arrived there in panic. These strangers say that a sudden blackout has swept New York, and with nowhere else to turn, they've come to the country in search of shelter. But with the TV and internet down and no cell service, the facts are unknowable. Should Amanda and Clay trust this intruding couple and vice versa? What has happened back in New York? Is the vacation home isolated from the civilization truly a safe place for their families? And are they safe from one another? Suspenseful and provocative, Rahman Alam's third novel is keenly attuned to the complexities of parenthood, race, and class. Leave the World Behind explores how our closest bonds are reshaped and unexpected new ones forged in moments of crisis. I think, like I said, there's so much potential here, and I hope that it is just as phenomenal as it sounds. So I'm excited for this one. And lastly, the last 2 books we have, I know we're already finished. It's been, what, like an hour? We have 2 books by the same author, and that's by Alex North, and we have The Whisper Man and The Shadows by Alex North. This book is about a man who moves to a small town with his son, and he is a detective, and he is trying to figure out who is recreating this, like, serial killer's works, because the serial killer was already behind bars, and they're trying to figure out, okay, like, did that person get out? Is there someone else trying to copycat the murders? But basically, he lures kids out of their beds from their bedroom by whispering in their window, which is why he's called the Whisper Man. Super creepy. Just the premise of that makes me, like, want to, like, leave that window right there alone. Like, I am, like, so scared right now. So I'm excited to get to this one. And The Shadows is about a group of friends who were friends with this guy who committed a crime that is seen as unforgivable by a lot of people. And basically, they're trying to find out more and see if what they always thought was true is actually true, or if there's something more sinister under the surface. So needless to say, I'm excited about that book as well. But those are all of these 60 plus books. I am so tired and my back is killing me, but I hope you enjoyed this video. I am so glad that I was able to haul all of these. Again, this is 6 months worth of books, so please don't feel like I bought all these recently. That's not the case. Regardless, if you've read any of these, please let me know down in the comments what you thought of them. If you're excited to read any of these, let me know if you want to do like a buddy read kind of situation. That'd be fun. But other than that, if you like this video, please give it a big thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And also, hit that post notification bell so you're notified every time that I post a new video. Until next time, bye.